friends, we will continue today further with the discussion on human physiology in Ayurveda. In this lecture, we will consider the hemopartic system as described in Ayurvedic textbooks. So, as I discussed in my previous lecture, hemopartic system is to be understood under the umbrella of Raktavaha Srutas according to Ayurveda, whereas Rasavaha Srutas is mostly indicative of circulatory system. Though Rasa and Rakta, they circulate together in the body, the nomenclature is more indicative of these different entities or systems. So Raktavaha Srutas is specifically mentioned to be related with Yakrit and Pliha, that is liver and spleen. Shonitavahanam srutasam yakrit moolam plihacha. The role of liver, as long as erythropoiesis is concerned, is well known. Liver synthesizes RBCs during the intrauterine life. It also stores vitamin B12, folic acid and iron, and it produces many clotting factors also. Whereas spleen is the site where RBCs are broken down after they complete their lifespan. So the role of liver and spleen in erythropoiesis or hemopartic system as such is well known. And this is actually surprising to know that in Charaka Samhita, the role of these two organs has been very clearly mentioned in the context of Shonitavaha Srutas. Further, it has been mentioned in Sushruta Samhita that yattu yakrit plihinoho pittam tasmin ranjako agniriti samnya. The pitta which is present in yakrit and pliha contains the agni known as ranjaka agni. So ranjaka pitta contains ranjaka agni. That is how it has to be understood. Yattu yakrit plihinoho pittam, the pitta which is residing in yakrit and pliha, tasmin, in that pitta, Ranjako Agni, the Ranjaka Agni is present. And sa rasasya ragakrit uktaha, the function of this Ranjaka Agni is to give color to the rasa. So rasa becomes colored because of the action of Ranjaka Agni. So rasa is a colorless fluid, because rasasya cha na rago asti, it has been mentioned. So it is a colorless fluid, but it contains lot of nutrients. Whereas rakta is the red colored fraction which is present in the blood. Further, it has been mentioned that tejo bhutaha param sukshmaha sa rakta rasa uchyate. I discussed this in my previous lecture in the context of the absorption of sarabhaga after the completion of the digestion, that is tejo bhutaha, after the action of jatharagni, the sukshma bhaga, the minutest fraction which gets absorbed, is called rasa according to Sushruta, whereas in Ataka Darpana it has been mentioned that this is called rakta rasa, because rakta and rasa, they circulate together. Again, this has to be kept in mind while reading this verse of Sushruta Samhita. Rasasya ragakrut uktaha means rasa gets red color because of the activity of ranjakagni. And it has to be also kept in mind that the absorbed materials, they have to reach the liver. Most of the absorbed materials, they reach the liver, and from liver they enter the systemic circulation. So the rasa dhatu which reaches hridaya is actually to be understood to be reaching hridaya after crossing the liver, and in the liver it gets converted into rakta. So rasa and rakta, they simultaneously move in the circulatory system. Again, another very interesting thing to note is that a reference from Sushruta Uttara Tantra. Ati nisruta rakto va kshaudra yuktam pibet asrak yakritva bhakshet ajam amam pitta samayutam. Whenever there is excessive loss of blood and of course resulting anemia, then either the blood should be consumed along with the honey, or the liver has to be administered along with all its contents. This is what has been suggested by Sushruta. Though the consumption of blood is not practical and neither advisable, but this second advice of Sushruta is very interesting and important. He advises that yakrit should be administered, that is, liver should be administered, yakritva bhakshayet ajam amam, aja, that is goat liver, right? Amam, raw goat liver is to be administered. Pitta samayutam. Pitta samayutam means the liver is the site of pitta, and along with all its contents. So the raw goat liver has to be administered whenever there is excessive blood loss. This is a very important and interesting observation, because in 1934, three scientists named Whipple, Minot and Murphy were awarded with the Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine for their discoveries concerning liver therapy in cases of anemia. So this was their contribution, and of course they did not know why did this happen. Now we know that liver is a very good storehouse of vitamin B12, and actually it is the vitamin B12 which is helping in the treatment of anemia, and in pernicious anemia, for instance, this is one of the very important way of treatment. So this becomes very important from the historical point of view, because this has been already documented in Sushruta Samhita. Now coming to the role of bone marrow. The role of bone marrow has also been explained in Ayurveda. Sthulasthishu visheshena majja atu abhyantarashritah athetareshu sarveshu saraktam meda uchyate. This is again from Sushruta Samhita. The meaning of this verse is sthulasthishu visheshena, in big bones, the dhatu which is present inside the bones is known as majja. So majja is present within the bones which are big. So sthulasthishu visheshena majja tu abhyantarashritah, inside the bones, bony cavities, there is majja. But this is only true for huge bones or large bones. But in other bones, what is there? In other bones, there is something called saraktam medha uchyate. So if you consider the red bone marrow and yellow bone marrow, in adult life, the red bone marrow is restricted to certain bones, such as the ribs, vertebrae, flat bones, maybe hip bones or cranial bones, and so on. This red bone marrow is not present in the long bones. Only at the epiphyseal ends, the red bone marrow is present. But otherwise, yellow bone marrow is present. And yellow bone marrow cannot form the blood cells. So, in this reference, this explanation becomes important. Athetureshu sarveshu, in all other bones, like irregular bones and flat bones, there is something called saraktam medha uchyate. Sarakta medha, that is, medha and rakta, not only, not majja, instead of majja, there is rakta and medha. And very surprisingly, the composition of bone marrow, histological composition of bone marrow, is actually the fat cells or adipocytes and blood cell precursors. These are the two cells that make up the red bone marrow, especially in the ratio of almost 1:1. So saraktam medha uchyate, sarakta medha, adipocytes is medha and rakta is blood cell precursors. So these are the two very important terms that have been indicated to be present in bones which are other than long bones, means possibly the irregular bones and other flat bones. Maybe they knew this because of the similar physiology which is present in certain mammals other than humans. Maybe they had observed this different kinds of bone marrows in certain animals. This is how they could have understood this. But nevertheless, this explanation becomes very important. Then, role of stomach. Amashyashriyam pittam ranjakam rasaranjanat. Again, according to Ashtanga Hridaya, the site of ranjaka pitta is amashya. Whereas, according to Sushruta Samhita, it is yakrita and pliha. But in Ashtanga Hridaya, the role of the site of ranjaka pitta is said to be amashya. And again, we know that the stomach plays some important role in hemopoiesis, because the Kassel's intrinsic factor is secreted from the stomach, and it combines with the vitamin B12, and in the absence of this intrinsic factor, the vitamin B12 cannot be absorbed. And if vitamin B12 is not absorbed, then there could be problems with the maturation of RBCs. So for RBC maturation and DNA synthesis, we need vitamin B12 and folic acid. So vitamin B12, if it is not absorbed, then there could be problems. And this specifically happens in conditions like a pernicious anemia. So again, this observation assumes very much importance as long as physiology is concerned. Now, what happens to the RBCs? How do they function? What is their function? So this has been explained clearly in Shangadhara Samhita, where he says that anabhisthaha pranapavanaha sprishtva hrutkamalantaram kanthat bahirviniryati patum vishnupadamratam pitvacha ambarapiyusham punarayati vegataha priyanayan dehamakhilam jivamcha jatharanlam. The meaning is the pranavayu or pranapavana during the process of respiration gets out of the body, and it catches something very vital that is present in the external atmosphere, and once again returns into the lungs through the respiration, through the act of respiration. And then this substance or the factor which has been captured from the external atmosphere, this is responsible for the nourishment of entire body and also the jiva. Jiva is again another synonym of rakta. Raktam jiva iti sthitihi. It has been mentioned. So once again, we'll read this shloka. Nabhistha pranapavana. Pranapavana or pranavayu is located in nabhi, and it comes out of the body. Sprishtva hrutkamalantaram. Hrutkamalantaram is through the sides of the heart. So through the sides of the heart, this pranavayu comes out, and then what happens? Kanthat bahir vinirayati, through the throat it comes out, bahir vinirayati patum vishnupadamritam, it captures the vishnupadamrita. Amrita is nectar like substance which is present in the vishnupada. Vishnupada is nothing but atmosphere. Vishnupada and Ambara Piyusha, these are the two synonyms, and they represent the akasha or the space or atmosphere. So this amrita like substance, the substance which is similar to amrita, is present in the external atmosphere, and through the act of respiration it is consumed or captured, and apitva, after consuming it, this pranavayu re-enters. Ambara piyusham punarayati vegataha, it once again re-enters the body, and then what happens? It nourishes priyanayan dehamakhilam, it nourishes the entire body, and also the jiva, it nourishes the jiva, and also the jatharagni, the jatharagni present in the digestive system, right? So here the capturing of something vital which is present in the external atmosphere through the act of respiration, and ultimately delivery of this important substance to the jiva, and from the jiva there onwards dehamakhilam, throughout the body. So this is indicative of capture of oxygen and delivery of oxygen through the jiva, because jiva is nothing but rakta. So rakta, again, the function of rakta is jivana, to give jiva. So these are certain important terminologies which have some physiological significance. So this is again important that it has been mentioned, maybe not very directly but indirectly, that through the act of respiration we consume very vital entity that is present in the atmosphere, and then this entity is required for the nourishment of entire body, or maybe for the living of entire body, life, because jiva or jivana is indicative of life. So it is life giving principle. It is not only nourishing factor, rather it is rather the life giving principle. Now again there is a confusion regarding the mentioning of lungs. So there is one reference, very interesting reference again in Sushruta Samhita, which reads like tasyadho vamataha pliha pupusascha dakshinato yakrut klomacha. So tasya adho vamataha, tasya means it is in the reference of heart. So adho vamataha, vama is left side, adho is inferior. So on the left and inferior aspect of heart there is pliha and pupusa. So pliha and pupusa are the organs situated on the inferior and left side of the heart respectively. Okay, so similarly on the right side dakshinato yakrut klomacha. So on the inferior side, right hand side, there is yakrut, that is liver, and on the right side you have cloma. So pupusa and cloma seem to be referring to the lungs, pupusa standing for left lung and cloma for right lung, because pupusa is the term which has been never used in plural form. Pupusau should have been used if they had lungs in their mind for pupusa, but such usage is never found in the textbooks. Always it is pupusa, whereas cloma is present in the right lung, right side. So cloma possibly represents right lung, and pupusa possibly represents the left lung, and according to some commentators, again this has been further clarified that cloma and pupusa are one and same. Now tadvishuddham hirudharam balavarna sukhayusha yunakti pranenam pranah shonitam hi anuvartate. So we just saw that according to Shanrudra Samhita, it is the pranavayu which comes out of the thoracic cavity and captures the ambara piyusha, and then re-enters the body and then nourishes the rakta or jiva. So in this context it is important to note that pranaha shonitam hi anuvartate. So praninam pranaha, so this life principle or prana, it moves along with the shonita. Anuvartate means it follows the shonita. So tadvishuddham hi rudhiram balavarna sukhayusha tadvishuddham hi rudhiram, when the rudhira is vishuddha or pure, it leads to the bala, that is normal natural immunity, normal immunity, and varna, normal complexion, and sukhayusha, good health and longevity, and yunakti praninam pranaha. So praninam pranaha, so prana of the animals or human beings are yunakti praninam pranaha shonitam hi anuvartate. So these pranas in the human body or human beings are normally functioning through following the shonita. This is how it has to be understood. So shonitam hi anuvartate. So possibly this is indicative of the blood gases which circulate along with the blood cells. This is how we can interpret. Of course it is an indirect reference. Now what happens to the RBCs when they complete their lifespan? They are broken down, metabolized, and especially in liver and spleen, and then they are metabolized into heme and globin are separated out. This heme portion is further metabolized into Billy Burden, and finally bilirubin. And this bilirubin enters the liver and gets excreted through the bile. And surprisingly, the pitta has been explained to be the mala of rakta in Ayurveda. So asrajaha pittam malaha. This has been discussed during the digestion physiology also. I have explained earlier that the pitta which is released during amlavastha paka is malarupi pitta, and I explained that it is achha pitta, and acham iti aghanam it has been mentioned. So this is malarupi pitta, and this malarupi pitta is nothing but the pitta of rakta, because rakta is red colored fraction and its byproduct is yellow colored fraction, and that is nothing but the malarupi pitta. So param tu pachyamanasya vidagdhasya amla bhavatah, this is the explanation of amla avastha paka. As you might remember, param tu pachyamanasya vidagdhasya amla bhavatah ashayat chavamanasya pittam achcha mudiryate. So achcha pitta which is secreted in the small intestine is actually the byproduct of this rakta. So this is how you get the complete picture of physiology of hemopoietic system. And similarly, to support this view, once again we can go through the pitta vriddhi lakshana, or features of pitta vriddhi, clinical features of pitta vriddhi. Pitta vidmutra netratvak, yellowish discoloration of sclera, conjunctiva, urine, fecal matter, and even skin, right? So pitta vidmutra netratvak, shutra dahalp nidrataha. So hunger, thirst, alpanidratal, lack of sleep. See, these are the features which are produced due to the pitta vriddhi, and possibly these are the features produced due to the vriddhi of malarupi pitta, which is the mala of rakta.